they don't have it in stock and it's $20 a piece and you would need six of them, so we'll just keep it.
$20?
Yeah.
Damn.
Okay, so what are you know you called that? The bus bar.
Okay, so let me show you.
Okay, so this is the basic wiring diagram for the heated bed. So this is the socket, right? And this is the A phase and the B phase. There'll be two of them since we're running single phase power. That is ground. Okay, and current is always trying to flow from one of the phases to the other, depending on which one depends on what phase of power you're in right now, and that changes 60 times a second.
Okay.
So it's always trying to get from A to B or from B to A.
All you have to do, man, is
toe clamp it like we did last time.
Yeah, and drill half the holes, and then rotate it.
It's not a super precision thing as long as within each pattern the holes are all the same. You'll want to make sure the counter bores are down. We gonna sweep that in with the edge finder, with the indicator?
Yeah.
Yeah, so I guess we can just do this half and just rotate
it around.
Should be fine.
Yep, and we got it upside down, which is good.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Pretty close to done, actually. The basic components for the heated bed are, of course, the aluminum bed itself, which will need holes, mounting holes drilled in it. But the primary heating elements are these Arcol Omite 50 watt resistors. Use a lot of them so that we wouldn't have hot spots in the bed. This way we can use more of them and have the heat more distributed than if we used 100 watt setups. The second thing we've got is this Uxell 40 amp DC-AC solid state relay, and that comes with a radiator, which is really important for getting a decent fraction of the rated amperage out of it without it overheating. We're going to derate that quite a bit. It's rated for 40 amps max output. Everyone says to derate them less than half, so it shouldn't ever take more than 15 amps or so. The next thing we've got is a 142 Celsius cutoff fuse. It'll also burn out if it takes more than 10 amps, so we're gonna use two of them at one time.
Okay, so this is what you got right here.
Yep, that's what those are. Right. That's in case the SSR does fail and we wind up stuck in the open position. That'll cut the power before the bed gets too hot at 142 Celsius, which is still very hot, but isn't going to start a fire. In fact, it shouldn't start a fire even if those fail. Just because the ambient temperature the aluminum should get to is only 200 Celsius, which is, again, a very great personal burn hazard, but not as much of a fire hazard. And the last thing is this Ancor stranded 14 gauge wiring, and that's 15 feet. And we're gonna use that for the high amperage stuff around the SSR and for grounding.
Okay, so yeah, 14 gauge wire.
Yep.
All right. It's just regular 14 gauge wire? Or?
It's stranded, yeah.
Okay.
Stranded takes heat, and it heat a lot better.
Okay. Oh, it does?
Yeah, it's got less resistance per foot when it's stranded than when
really?
It's solid. Yeah, so wire, when it's solid, electrons are negatively charged, right?
Yeah.
When they're moving, they try and move away from each other.
Uh-huh.
So you only use the shell of a single strand wire. When it's stranded, you use the shells of all the wires, so it's proportional to surface area to some degree. So the surface area of a solid wire is not efficient.
No, okay.
So most braided wire is braided in such a way that an electron will try to move to the outside of the wire, but because it's moving against electrons in the other strands of wire,
it
pushes it back and it uses the whole cross-section.
Okay, all right, cool.
So stranded is usually better in resistance. It's also a lot more flexible.
Okay.
Because solid wire that thick would want to break when it bends.
Yeah. Nice, that's good.
This is the SSR, it's a switch. It can just cut phase A off, depending on what signal or ground looks like. So this is 60 hertz power. It switches back and forth all the time, but if this opens, then power can't get from B to A. So current stops, right? Bear in mind, of course, that the distribution bars are still hot. So they still have to be insulated as long as it's plugged in.
Okay.
It goes, each phase goes to one of the two distribution bars where it's distributed out to all 30 of the resistors. I've only drawn some of them because drawing all 30 wouldn't make sense.
Yeah.
So they're all wired in parallel, not in series, or you won't get enough current. So all 30 of them will be in parallel from these bars. You'll want to put the bars in an insulated box somewhere, just so they can't touch anything.
Mm-hmm.
And I've drawn ground because we're specifically going to ground the bed and the frame. In case something does go wrong and one of those bars does touch the bed, it'll short to ground instead of making the frame hot and electrocuting the next person to touch it.
Yeah.
So that will make things much safer. The other thing we will want to do is they make a type of outlet called a GFCI. And a GFCI looks at the ground, and if it detects any current actually flowing through the ground, it kills the power.
Okay.
It's just a type of outlet, and we'll want to run. We'll probably want to run this on one of those.
Gotcha. How much is something like that? So that, hold on, that kind of works like a fuse, don't it?
No, because it's resettable.
Okay.
GFCIs, they're used in bathrooms a lot, so that you don't electrocute yourself when your razor gets
it. Yeah. Okay. Exactly. It has the little button.
It has the little button. It's exactly like that.
Nice.
They make industrial scale ones.
Okay. Cool.
So. Oh, the other thing, which I will add, is one of these will probably have a thermal cutout in it. And that thermal cutout will be attached to the bed. We'll probably just glue it on with some thermal compound or thermal adhesive.
Mm-hmm.
And when it reaches a certain temperature, we'll probably set it to 150 Celsius or 200 Celsius.
Yeah.
When it reaches that temperature, it kills it. Now bear in mind, that won't do anything if there's a short.
Yeah.
So the GFCI is what you want. We'll also, well, if it's a thermal fuse, it will do something for a short because too much amperage will heat it up. Fuse in line for shorts. We'll have a we'll have an SSR for control. We'll have a thermal cutout for if the SSR fails and it fails open.
Okay.
So we don't overheat the thing.
Yeah.
Now it should not be able to start fires, even if it does fail open and the thermal cutout fails. But it will be a burn hazard. Just for touching it. Last thing of all. That wood we're gonna want to take off, and we'll replace it with probably an eighth inch thickness of steel.
Okay.
That won't be super strong, but it's getting most of
the definitely minimize anything that could catch fire.
Yep.
Last thing we want to do is start a fire.
That is the very last thing. GFCIs. Since you're gonna need to put an outlet out there anyway, you can probably just put in the GFCI.
Yeah.
You probably really want to because I doubt that'll be super water.
You know, definitely.
Guess whatever, if you talk to an electrician or something.
Yeah, we're actually going to wire all that up ourselves, so.
Okay. I'll look up where you can get the GFCI then.
Okay. Might be able to get one at Home Depot.
Probably.